MCAT 2017 CRAM, Biochemical and Biological Foundations of Living Systems, Passage 13, Carbohydrates, the Structure and Function of Glycogen. As you view the reading of the passage, you'll notice some highlighted snippets of text. What I want you to do is garner meaning from these specific selections in order to answer the questions that follow. Good luck and happy reading. Figure 1, glycogen tetramer. Okay, so take it all in, all the glucose rings, the glycosidic bonds, both alpha-1-4 and alpha-1-6. All right. Okay. Paragraph 1. This molecule is a good representation of the structural aspects of glycogen because it clearly depicts two different types of glycosidic linkages that confer the distinctive branching pattern of glucagon. The reactions creating these linkages during glycogen synthesis are catalyzed by glycogen synthase and glycogen branching enzyme. The reactions that cleave these linkages during the breakdown of glycogen are catalyzed by glycogen phosphorylase and glycogen debranching enzyme. For instance, glycogen phosphorylase catalyzes the cleavage of the glycosidic linkage between the anomeric carbon of one glucose subunit and the fourth carbon position of the adjacent glucose subunit. The liver, kidney, and muscle contain ample supplies of these and other enzymes involved in the synthesis and breakdown of glycogen. Paragraph 2. Mutations in the genes for the above-mentioned enzymes can result in a variety of metabolic diseases that fall under the umbrella term of glycogen storage disease, GSD for short. The following table lists 5 main types of GSD. So let's take a look at this table. Table 1, 5 types of glycogen storage disease, GSD for short. Hypoglycemia refers to the low levels of circulating blood glucose. Hepatomegaly refers to an enlarged liver. And cirrhosis is a serious condition of the liver resulting in the accumulation of scar tissue. You can think of it as having internal scabs in the liver. Okay, so we have listed the GSD type. 0 through 6, excluding type 1 and 2. Not sure that there even is a type 1 or 2. We have the enzyme deficiency, whether hepatomegaly and hypoglycemia are present or not, and then the prognosis for an individual with the glycogen storage disease, okay? Prognosis, you can think of it as the outcome or what's going to unfold for an individual with this type of disease, even to the point of expiration, possibly because of this deficiency, okay? Not always the case, but sometimes it is. All right. How many anomeric carbons are contained in the molecule depicted in Figure 1? Is it A, 4, B, 8, C, 20, or D, 24? I'll give you a moment to think. This requires outside knowledge, unless you want to sit there and count, which is really inefficient and not a good test-taking skill. All right. Use a quick rule of thumb to decide how many anomeric carbons there are. An anomeric carbon is the stereocenter created at the carbonyl carbon, okay, of a carbohydrate when the molecule goes from the straight chain form to its cyclical form. So the molecule depicted in Figure 1 has 4 such stereocenters, all right? The molecule depicted in figure 1 has 4 anomeric carbons. All right. Okay. If the glycogen polymer in figure 1 were reacted with glycogen phosphorylase and excess phosphate anion, how many molecules of glucose 1-phosphate would be produced? A, 1, B, 2, C, 3, or D, 4? I'll give you a moment to think. Outside knowledge is required for this answer. Or you could deduce it based on the evidence in the passage. Okay, now for the good stuff, some biochemistry. Glycogen phosphorylase catalyzes the hydrolysis of the terminal alpha-1-4 linkage of glycogen. There are two such linkages depicted in the molecule in figure 1. Okay. You have to remember that enzymes are regenerated in a reaction, and glycogen has two types of glycosidic linkages that each require a different separate enzyme mentioned in the passage to catalyze the hydrolysis of each linkage. Hence, only two molecules of glucose 1-phosphate would be produced. Okay? All right. Using figure 1 as a reference, glycogen contains which of the following types of glycosidic linkages? Is it going to be alpha-1-4, 2-alpha-1-6, 3-alpha-1-1? So the possible answer choices are A, 1 and 3 only, B, 1 only, C, 1 and 2 only, or D, 2 and 3 only. I'll give you a moment to decide. All right. Okay, so the anomeric carbon in the cyclic form of glucose is numbered 1. The methyl group on the fifth carbon in the glucose ring is numbered 6. Hence, glycogen contains alpha-1-4 and alpha-1-6 linkages. Okay? All right. Storing glucose as a large branch polymer likely arose as an evolutionary adaptation that conferred a selective advantage over organisms that stored glucose in straight chain form or as individual phosphorylated glucose molecules. Which of the following does not represent a possible explanation for this selective advantage? Is it A, large branch polymers of glucose take up less volume and precipitate less easily than large unbranched polymers? B, large branch polymers of glucose are able to form chylomicrons more easily, resulting in increased ease of transport in the blood? Is it C, large branch polymers of glucose do not increase the osmotic pressure in cells to the extent that individual glucose molecules would? Or is it D, large branch polymers of glucose can offer many simultaneous sites for hydrolysis of glycosidic links? This requires some outside knowledge, but for some of you geniuses, it doesn't. You can kind of intuit or infer the correct answer from these long explanations. All right, let's get to it. Okay, so a large unbranched polymer of glucose molecules has only two terminal ends, while a large branch polymer of glucose molecules will have many terminal ends, okay? So
glycogen phosphorylase works on terminal ends, and it can do its thing simultaneously at multiple sites. Osmotic pressure. So answer choice D, yeah, this is correct. It's out. Osmotic pressure increases with molarity, okay? So this is out as well. And chylomicrons are lipoproteins and have nothing to do with glucose transport. So large branch polymers of glucose do not more easily transport in the blood and do not represent a possible explanation of the selective advantage of storing glucose as glycogen, okay? This does, as well as this. And this is like ill explained, okay? All right. The symptoms of GSD type 1 is glycogen storage disease type 1. Oh, so there is a type 1. Earlier I had said I wasn't sure if there was a type 1 or 2, but maybe there's a 2 as well. Not shown in table 1, okay? Which results from a deficiency in glucose 6-phosphatase, a liver enzyme that catalyzes the conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to glucose, would most closely resemble which disease from table 1? Would it be GSD type 0 with an enzyme deficiency in glycogen synthase? Would it be GSD type 4 with an enzyme deficiency in glycogen branching enzyme? Would it be GSD type 5, where we see a deficiency in muscle glycogen phosphorylase? Or would it be GSD type 6 with a deficiency in liver glycogen phosphorylase? I'll give you a moment to think. This, if you know your enzyme function and purpose, this should be pretty easy. And you can definitely refer back to the passage to help out with this one, okay? Okay, so GSD type 0 through GSD type 4 all have to do with the synthesis of glycogen, all right? GSD type 5 results from a deficiency in a muscle enzyme, not a liver enzyme. So both GSD type 6 and GSD type 1 affect the pathway by which liver glycogen is converted to glucose for transport out of the liver and throughout the body through the bloodstream. So the symptoms of GSD type 1 most closely resemble GSD type 6. All right?